I consider the ion source the most complex of the cyclotron subsystems. It's where the beam is born. There are many types of ion sources, but we've settled on the Penning ion gauge type. Through this episode, we'll look at the concept of the Penning ion gauge, we'll dissect ours, rebuild it, and show its operation. So we're going to talk about the ion source that we're using now, which is the result of nearly a decade of miniature ion source evolution. We started out with a hot filament directly exposed that would burn out every sort of 10 minutes. It would take an hour to replace it, to attempts at heated cathode, arc discharge cathodes, and they melted things. It was a miserable experience. We finally settled on a cold cathode Penning ion gauge ion source, which works very well. We've had a lot of support from Timothy Antea, and some colleagues at IBA gave me hints and put us in the right direction. And this ion source, we built it. We actually thought it was going to be a prototype, and it just worked right out the gate beautifully, and we've not changed it since. And it's known as a Penning ion gauge. It relies on the fact that we immerse the ion source in a uniform magnetic field, which is easy in the cyclotrons. We put this right in the center of our machine. There's a tube, which we call the chimney. The tube is grounded. We inlet some hydrogen gas. Pressure inside here is probably on the order of tens of millitor. At either end of the chimney, at the top of the chimney and at the bottom of the chimney, there are two tantalum electrodes that are held at a negative voltage, so we call them cathodes. They're tied together to a negative high voltage power supply and are connected with reference to the grounded chimney. The grounded chimney has a small hole in it, and we call that the aperture. So if we have hydrogen gas flowing in, we're in this strong magnetic field, and we ramp up the high voltage on the power supply, the electrons will ultimately pop off of the surface of the cathodes and want to go to the grounded chimney wall. However, because of the strong magnetic field, they can't do that and leave the surface with the kinetic energy of the high voltage, which is on the order of a few hundred volts, and are constrained to spiral along the magnetic field lines until they approach the opposing cathode, which is at the same potential. Then they're de-accelerated, they come to rest, and then they are re-accelerated away and spiral back and forth. So this electron will make hundreds of trips before it works its way over to the grounded surface and is lost. So you get many, many passes from just one electron, and there's an arc's worth, you know, 10 milliamps worth of electrons coming off of the surface. While they're doing that, they're bumping into the neutral hydrogen gas that we're flowing in and ionizing it and leaving behind the heavy proton ions. And it's happening everywhere, but specifically in the region of the aperture, an electric field sneaks in from the pullers that are connected to the D. And when the D is negative in its RF cycle, there's a strong electric field, penetrates a little bit into the plasma that's formed inside and extracts those ions. So this is these pullers enhance the electric field, or sometimes known as extraction electrodes, and pull out positive ions, protons in our case, and start them on their cyclotron journey.
When we zoom in, we can see the effect of the puller, not only enhancing the extraction field, but also causing a focusing effect. You can see the beam goes through a waste behind the puller. We need to rebuild the ion source. This needs to be done about every 100 hours of operation. As you see, we have amassed a pile of expended, heavily used ion source components from previous rebuilds. To begin the rebuild process, we've pulled the chamber from the magnet, placed it on a bench, and proceeded to open it up. The disassembly requires a specific order of operations, starting with the removal of the ion source flange, carefully disconnecting the high voltage lead, and guiding the gas capillary tube out of the chamber. Once the gas line and high voltage leads are removed, we can simply slide out the ion source and dummy D assembly. We will be replacing this chimney, which has an offset aperture used to intentionally drive betatron motion. We'll come back to that in a later episode. We will take this chamber opening opportunity to clean the D also. We proceed with the teardown of the ion source. First, we remove the ceramic-coated high-voltage connecting bar, which we call the goober. Note the darkening from years of bombardment by the ion beam. We need to take this assembly all the way apart, down to the cathodes for inspection, and possibly even replacement. The amount of erosion will determine if we need new cathodes. During operation, the tantalum cathodes undergo sputtering, which slowly removes the material. Upon inspection, we see that these still have a little bit of life left in them. From left to right, we can compare an unused, a partially used, and two heavily used cathodes which have had substantial erosion to the point of exposing the counterbore for the electrical lead. Our cleaning process starts with acetone, then methanol, and a bit of elbow grease. We use Scotch-Brite to scrub each of these components. The acetone aims to remove all organics, such as pump oil and fingerprints. The methanol removes the acetone residue. Then we wipe the components dry with Kim wipes. We are always careful to wear proper gloves to protect us as well as the freshly cleaned surfaces. After cleaning and inspection, we can reassemble the ion source, which is mostly the opposite order of operations from the disassembly. This is the chimney that I've selected to use. Its aperture will be in the midplane, and it has a slightly large diameter to increase the beam current. After the bottom cathode assembly is mounted, the chimney is placed in a slight counterbore and held in place by a resistance fit. Then we can place the upper cathode housing to fully capture the chimney and lock in its rotation. Next, we replace the goober, which has set screws that grab the high voltage lead of each of the cathodes. At this point, it is important to ensure the cathodes remain horizontal and do not rotate and hit the grounded housing. After cleaning the D, we install the extraction electrodes, also known as pullers. Note that this puller has a circular aperture. The D is reinserted, followed by the dummy D ion source assembly, and then I adjust the D's position to align the puller with the ion source. We return the service flange and connect the high voltage lead and reinsert the gas delivery line. I perform one final check to ensure the cathodes have not shifted and become shorted to ground. We seal up the chamber by properly using a star pattern tightening technique. Then carry the chamber over and place it into the magnet's gap. Now we are ready to give the ion source a test run. We begin the pump down sequence by roughing the chamber while the diffusion pump heats up. Once the diffusion pump is operating, we valve out the rough pump and valve in the diffusion pump, aiming for an ultimate pressure in the order of 10 to the minus 6 torr range. On a good day, even the high 10 to the minus 7. We tune up the RF and operate it in pulse mode with a peak power of about 300 watts. We select our species of ions from either a bottle of hydrogen, deuterium, helium, or helium-3. For this operation, we've selected hydrogen. We meter the hydrogen input by a mass flow controller set for hydrogen and adjust the flow rate to be about 0.55 standard cubic centimeters per minute. By selecting automatic operation, the mass flow controller will automatically regulate the gas flow. The mass flow controller's output is plumbed into the ion source gas delivery line. With the magnet on at a minimal field, the RF running, and the hydrogen gas flowing, all that is left is to turn on the ion source's high voltage. We ramp up the power supply's output voltage until an arc is struck. At which point the power supply switches into constant current mode. A freshly rebuilt source takes a few minutes to settle out as the cathode surfaces are conditioned, but from here on out it will be a smooth operation until it is time for the next rebuild. The failure, indicating the need for a rebuild, is generally an electric short from the buildup of sputtered tantalum cathode material. When the ion source is on, we can peer into the chamber to see the pullers extracting ions and the resulting plasma spray that launches the ion beam. We tune the magnetic field to satisfy the cyclotron condition to get beam, which we know we've achieved by either seeing the oscilloscope trace response that measures the beam current hitting the radial probe, or we can directly view the beam spot on the radial probe's phosphor screen, or ultimately send the beam down the deflection channel and see it light up the deflector's phosphor screen. The performance of the ion source can be characterized by the beam current extracted for a given DC D bias, pressure, and cold cathode arc current. As much as a half a milliamp has been extracted, but this is at an extreme operation which would greatly limit the ion source lifetime. A typical operating point is between 5 and 10 milliamps of discharge current. With peak D voltages of about 5 kilovolts, this leads to a few tens of microamps from the source.
The next step required to accelerate the beam that the ion source has produced is to generate an oscillating electric field between the faces of the D. The RF or radio frequency system is responsible for this. We will take a detailed look into the RF system in the next episode.